back tonight. Don't give up, don't let go. I'll make this right. I'll dig through sorrow and disgust. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Don't give up. All right, so after check interventions, check level of consciousness, xABC is a treat as you go acronym. So as soon as you encounter any of these issues, you fix them right then and there because you have a little bit of time at this minute. We're still not going to dawdle because there's something called the golden hour where you have an hour from the time of injury till the time they're on the operating table. And we've already spent a lot of time finishing that mission, so be very conscious of that hour. But you know, have a little bit of time to invest in these things to give them the best chance of living, because these are worthwhile investments that have been proven over time. So take the time and do all this stuff. Even though it seems kind of tedious, you can do it really quickly. You just have to practice. For practice, I recommend going to some medic classes and talking to some medics, have them put some scenarios together for you. And if you go to some really good classes, some good TCCC classes, or even some other, you know, fire department classes that a fire department might put on for the county citizens, they'll dress up in moulage people or put fake wounds on people, so you actually find the things as you're going through the assessment. And they'll act out the parts too, whether it's unconsciousness or altered level of consciousness. That's a really good way of learning. All right, so treat as we go. Where the X is gonna mean exsanguinating bleed. So if they're bleeding and it's life-threatening, fix it. You have a little bit more time now, especially as we do the head to toe, you'll be able to feel and look at your hands, see if they got wet with blood. So those are some ways that we can treat that life-threatening bleeding. Any other life threats that you know of? So if you know they were shot in the chest, I would just go ahead and move on to sealing that chest wound with a chest seal, a gloved hand in the meantime, and then maybe from your buddy while you get the occlusive dressing ready, put that chest seal on there. The chest seal is a type of occlusive dressing, but you're gonna get that wound sealed up, and then, as I said in the chest seal video, you're gonna check the other side. You're checking for an exit wound for every entrance wound that you have. So make sure you treat that. Any life threats you see like that, go ahead and knock them out now. And we're going to systematically go through every other system that's relevant to this so that we don't miss anything. And that's the whole purpose of having an ABC or a MARCH acronym, is so that you don't miss anything and so that you get a nice uniform assessment for every patient that you go on, and hopefully you don't have to go on any that are teammates. Anyway, so after those life threats are treated, we're going to move down to the airway. So obviously A is airway, ABC, airway breathing circulation. We're going to make sure that's open and patent. So if they're sitting there talking to you, that's a good sign. That means it's open and patent. That's, you don't have to do anything for their airway. Now, if they're sitting there gurgling or laying there gurgling, they're going to need suction because something is drowning them, essentially. If they're snoring, they're going to need an airway. And honestly, if they're gurgling after you suction them, put in an airway anyway. Anyone that's unconscious, put in a nasal airway. And if they're super unconscious, put in a oral airway. The oral airway is superior. On the other hand, the nasal airway is not going to make that patient gag or vomit, so it's a safe bet. Then again, if you got a lot of trauma in this region here, you're not going to want to put a nasal airway in, so you're going to have to figure out the best you can in those circumstances whether you need to put an NPA in, nasal airway, or an OPA in, and go from there. And that's only a part of it, because you got to open their airway manually. You got to position their head in the right position. And going by the book, you're also going to have to maintain cervical spine immobilization. So keep that in mind. Immediately send your buddy to cover that. Just remember that basic airways are adjuncts, which means they're done in addition to positioning that airway. B is going to be for breathing. As we move down to breathing, we're going to go ahead and get the rate, rhythm, and quality. Normal breathing range is 12 to 20 breaths per minute. What we're going to do is give oxygen for anything in that range or around that range, immediately surrounding it. And we're going to add the bag valve mask, that mask that we squeeze that artificially ventilates. When we get anywhere below that normal range, probably 10 I would say, or below, we start go ahead and ventilate artificially with the BVM. And then anything above 28, also ventilate artificially with that BVM. And especially when it's fast, rapid breathing, when they're breathing too fast, you go ahead and match them with your BVM, match that respiration rate, and then slow it down a little bit. That's coaching, essentially. We're slowing it down to the normal range between 12 and 20 breaths per minute. So a low breathing rate would be 10 or below that we would treat with a bag valve mask. Higher than 28, we'll say, we would treat with a bag valve mask. Shallow respiration, so shallow breaths, treat with that bag valve mask. Oxygen for everybody is a good idea, especially when we suspect that they might be going into shock. And shock is going to be its whole module on its own. It's actually going to have to be a series of modules. But there are several types of shock that can happen. The biggest one that we're worried about with the X is going to be hypovolemic shock, because they are losing their blood. It's the most common sense. C is going to be for circulation. So airway, breathing, circulation. When we talk about circulation, we're talking rate, rhythm, and character. And when we're discussing that, we're talking about their radial pulse, primarily what we start off with. So any patient I get, no matter if it was medical or trauma, any patient, I'm gonna, as I'm assessing the other things, I'm gonna go ahead and grab their wrists and I'm going to feel for that radial pulse. Now, a pro tip on pulses. You are gonna suck at taking pulses until you practice it to the point where you get bored with it and tired of it, and then still practice it more. When I was instructing in the classroom, I would have the recruits every single day check at least 5 other recruits' pulse, respirations, blood pressure, and breath sounds. Breath sounds sounds like something, you know, boring, but you're not gonna understand what abnormal breath sounds are until you get a whole bunch of experience listening to those normal breath sounds, so you can kind of differentiate between the two. So there's no good way to get good at it aside from that. Actually putting that practice in ahead of time, this is not gonna be a good time to practice. We need to be very confident in the objective data that we're getting. So airway, breathing, circulation, this is all objective data so that we can do the right treatments. And so they can get the right follow-up care once they're with a doctor or a surgeon. Back to the subject at hand, we've got their radials, we're palpating or we're feeling that pulse in their radial. So this is the radius bone, this is the ulna bone. We're saying radial because it's against this radial bone right here. We're just pressing an artery up against that hard surface or a bone, and we're feeling how fast it's beating. If you're not getting anything, immediately check the carotid. So we're gonna check the carotid in the neck and see if we're getting a pulse there. We checked for 10 seconds and there's no pulse there. That's not a good sign. Unfortunately, without that carotid pulse and with significant body trauma, possibly multi-system trauma, we're not gonna go through the process of CPR because it is inefficient use of time. Now, if that's your buddy and the mission is done, everybody's safe, security is set, and you've got everything coming, you've got some sort of transportation coming for them, go ahead and work them. Do the best you can because everything else is done, and so this is the only thing you have left to do. Go ahead and work them. Do the best you can, I would say. I couldn't live with myself if I didn't try in that situation. You can go ahead and move on to the CPR process. Just know that when there's a traumatic cardiac arrest, it's generally not gonna go very well. So if you're able to do what you had to do and then immediately get back to your buddy and they're in that state where they're needing CPR, go ahead and do it. The odds are not gonna be great, but go ahead and try it at that point. You have nothing to lose. If you've got anything to lose, even a little bit to lose by investing that time in that moment, forgo the CPR and do the other things that need to be done, because the odds are so slim. And especially if you've been gone, if you've had to clear that area for an extended amount of time, their chances get lower and lower every second that you're gone. So just keep that in mind. All right, so on to some of the less depressing stuff. If we feel for those radial pulses and we have something, that's good. That means they're in okay shape, at least at the moment. We're gonna get that rate, because the first thing is rate, rhythm, then character. So that rate, normal is gonna be 60 to 100 at rest. In these scenarios, we're not gonna be at rest, so expect the vitals to be a little bit spiked. I would say, depending on that person's fitness level, and you'll probably know this if you're on their team, gauge what is normal for them in a heart pounding, jacked up, adrenaline dump scenario, so that you know kind of what's normal for them. So in general, whenever I would come across somebody that was pinging, maybe someone that was in a vehicle wreck and they were just kind of panicking from that, or, you know, all jacked up from that, anything over 120 would be suspicious to me. So 60 to 100 is normal for resting, but I would say 120, after they've maybe been able to settle down for a minute from, you know, that ruck or that gunfight or whatever they've been doing, anything over 120 I would be suspicious of at that point. And the reason I'm suspicious of a high heart rate is that the body goes into a compensating mode because it's compensating for something. Now, that compensating could be for blood loss, or that compensating could be for a problem with the pump. So that heart's getting pressured from a tension pneumothorax, as we talked about in that video. So that elevated heart rate is going to make me start assuming, probably trending towards shock. And at that point, as long as we had a decent radial pulse, it's a compensated shock. So that's a good thing. We want to keep them in that, if at all possible. If we can do everything we need to keep them in that status. So keep that blood in the body. Now, there's some bleeding you're not going to be able to get to, but we're going to do our best. We're going to do the best we can. Because what happens after that is decompensated shock. And so what happens with that is, yes, the heart is still pounding away, still at that elevated rate. They're breathing fast, but they're not able to keep their blood pressure up. They're not able to compensate anymore with those things that your body does. So your heart's beating fast, your blood vessels tighten, blood is shunted or taken away from your skin and your extremities and put towards the core to keep those organs and your brain perfused. So once you move into that decompensated shock, you're running out of time. And if you don't fix it soon, they'll go into a irreversible shock. In which case, even if you save them with blood at the hospital, blood, fluids, all that kind of stuff at the hospital, they're still going to suffer a terrible, slow organ death as many multiple organs begin to die off. So we're doing XABC basically without any diagnostic tools aside from you. So while we have some semblance of a decent radial pulse, we're pretty good. When it starts to get weak, we know they're headed towards decompensated shock. When it's absent, they're in decompensated shock. Then when we're checking the carotid after that point, if it's strong, we know that they're in a very dangerous area and they need a minimal amount of fluids later on down the road to keep their blood pressure around the 80 millimeters of mercury mark. And that's called permissive hypotension, because if we put too much fluids in them, that's not blood. It's going to push out blood clots of where they were at. It's going to water down the blood. It's going to cause major issues. So that's why we want to get them to that 80 mark. So once we lose that pulse in the wrist or the radial, that means we're generally dropped down below 90. So we're in that danger zone. So just for the general rule of checking a radial pulse and checking a carotid, that radial pulse, if you've got it, is going to signify about a 90 plus systolic blood pressure. If that goes away, we're going to check the carotid, and that's if we feel a good strong carotid, that's good. So once that drops below 60 systolic, you're not going to feel a carotid pulse anymore. And in a normal circumstance, you would do CPR then. Gauge it. If you can, do it. So at the basic level, if they have a radial pulse, that's good. If they have no radial pulse and a carotid pulse, that means they're in a decompensated shock status, and it's very urgent that you get them transported immediately to where they get some blood transfused. But again, shock and checking pulses is its own video that I'll also put together in a module. For now, just kind of keep that in mind. Strong radial pulse, excellent. Fast radial pulse, compensated shock. Weak radial pulse, heading into decompensated shock. Absent radial pulse, carotid pulse present, you're in decompensated shock. Just as a simple rule of thumb. All right, so moving on, we did radial pulse. I did my little classroom spiel. Skin, so we check the skin, we want pink, warm, and dry is normal, what we consider normal. Of course, not everybody's gonna be pink, but look at their normal color, and is that normal for them? Are they more pale? We need to make note of that. Are they cool to the touch? That's another sign of shock. If they're cool and diaphoretic, diaphoretic means sweaty. If they're cool and clammy or cool and sweaty, that means they're also in a shock state, just depending on what phase in shock. Could be compensated, could be decompensated, could be irreversible. So again, we're going to use our pulses and check the pulses to determine where they're at. all stages of shock will generally have that cool, clammy, wet, pale skin, with the exception of spinal shock and other medical forms of shock, but we're not getting into that today. So closely related with the skin is the fingernail. So it's a capillary refill time. So we'll go ahead and press down on that nail, and we're gonna look at the nail bit underneath, and we're gonna see how fast that pink appears underneath that nail. And pretty much everyone doing modern Minuteman things will have a pink nail bed. Medical patients are kind of a different story, but we're pushing on that. We're letting go of it, and we're seeing if it takes more than 2 seconds. It takes more than 2 seconds to turn back to that pink color from that white blanching when you push it. That's a problem. Also an indicator of shock. Just note that as well. And so when we get the signs of shock, we got to treat for shock. So in addition to treating those life threats that we talked about earlier, when all that's kind of said and done, we're going to go ahead and position them laying down, ideally supine if you can do that, which means lay them on their back. But if not, generally you might have to put them on their side. Because at this point, you should be able to suction if needed. You can handle their airway. At this point, no matter if they're conscious or unconscious, you're going to want to put them in the supine position because you should have the tools to suction and get that airway cleared out if needed. Put that nasal airway in or put that oral airway in. Start those bag valve ventilations. And maybe the medic will intubate if you have a medic available. So get them supine. Elevate their legs a little bit. Get them warmed up. That's a huge part of shock treatment, is to get them wrapped in the blanket and warmed up. We already got the oxygen flowing because we got that going with the breathing, right? Because we knocked the things out as we came across them. And now we've already done our xABCs, and we're just in that kind of that last shock treatment for the last part of C. So we already got the O2 going. We got them positioned well now. We got their feet up. We're going to keep them warm with blankets or whatever you've got, even if it's one of those crappy emergency blankets, whatever you got to do to keep them warm. Keep that blood in the body. And just as a reminder, if you're riding with them or if you're the medic, don't over-bolus them with fluids. Don't give them too much fluids because that will cause a plethora of problems, from knocking out clots, as we said, to watering down the blood and kind of thinning the blood of red blood cells, which are already in high demand and low supply. And fluids also cool the body off too. Another thing that most people don't do in these scenarios that I would consider doing is would be to have a warm pack and kind of wrap it around IV tubing if you do an IV, so you can get some warm fluids going into their body to get them up to that, remember, that permissive hypotension, that 80 millimeters of mercury systolic. That way their organs are getting perfused and they may not necessarily be conscious, but it's keeping them alive so they can get to the hospital and get blood. And of course, as every EMT or medic knows, as the checkoff sheet goes, rapid transport to the hospital. That's going to be key. Have a place to take them to and get them there rapidly.